Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to Millennium TV News. This is Fahmid Islam with you. Before moving on, let's look at today's top stories. Obama hosts world leaders at White House. US, South Korea, Japan pledge security cooperation. India bridge collapse kills 14, scores feared trapped. Republicans alarmed at talk US may ease Iran trade. And will Brazil's Dilma Rousseff be impeached? Those were the headlines, now the details. US President Barack Obama hosts a working dinner at the White House for leaders attending the Nuclear Security Summit. U.S. President Barack Obama hosted a working dinner at the White House on Thursday for leaders attending the Nuclear Security Summit. Just as fears of nuclear terrorism are rising, U.S. President Barack Obama's drive to lock down vulnerable atomic materials worldwide seems to have lost momentum and could slow further. With less than 10 months left in office to follow through on one of his signature foreign policy initiatives, Obama will convene leaders from more than 50 countries in Washington this week for his fourth and final nuclear security summit, a high-level diplomatic process that started and will end on his watch. A boycott by Russian President Vladimir Putin, apparently unwilling to join in a US-dominated gathering at a time of increased tensions between Washington and Moscow, adds to doubts that the meeting will yield major results. The recent deadly militant attacks in Brussels have fueled concern that Islamic State could eventually target nuclear plants and develop radioactive dirty bombs, a topic that may well be uppermost in leaders' minds as they meet. Despite significant progress by Obama in persuading dozens of countries to rid themselves of bomb-making materials or reduce and safeguard stockpiles, much of the world's plutonium and enriched uranium remains vulnerable to theft. Japan and South Korea recommitted themselves with US President Barack Obama to each other's security amid ongoing threats from North Korea following a meeting alongside the Nuclear Security Summit in Washington.
And our shared commitment to promoting a more peaceful world. We are united in our efforts to deter and defend against North Korean provocations. We recognize that our security is linked, that we have to work together to meet this challenge. And we also recognize that it is important to the entire international community to vigilantly enforce the strong UN security measures that were passed in light of some of the ballistic missile and nuclear activity that Pyongyang has been engaging in. We've directed our teams to work diligently in the coming weeks and months to elaborate additional steps that we can take collectively in order to ensure that we have a denuclearized Korean Peninsula.
In order to jointly respond to such circumstances, we confirmed our commitment to strengthen the trilateral cooperation at all levels, which was a major achievement of this meeting.
A bridge under construction in the bustling Indian city of Calcutta collapsed on Thursday, killing at least 14 people with more than 100 people feared trapped. The bridge collapsed around noon local time, crushing rickshaws, cars and pedestrians. Rescue workers are now racing against time searching for survivors through the rubble. So far, at least 14 people are confirmed dead. More are expected. OP Singh, the Director General of India's National Disaster Response Force, says more than 100 people are feared trapped. He says,
because there's a lot of concrete, we're using cutters of all sorts to make holes in the debris so that we can make an entry. Only once we gain entry will the situation of the people trapped become clear.
The bridge was under construction at the time it collapsed, and residents say concrete had been laid the night before. The company building the bridge says it will fully cooperate with investigators as the search for victims continues.
There were many people standing under the bridge, one person said. Everything was buried. The concrete had been laid last night on this part of the bridge, another person said. Scores of people have been killed.
U.S. Republican lawmakers voiced deep concern on Thursday about reports that the Obama administration might allow Iran to use the dollar in some business transactions, although no such plans have been announced. U.S. government officials said the issue is being discussed in the Treasury Department, but any policy change would not involve widespread access for Iran to the U.S. financial system, disputing media reports suggesting otherwise. The Obama administration is considering easing some sanctions to permit non-U.S. companies to have some access to the U.S. financial system for U.S. dollar transactions involving Iran, said a U.S. official who spoke on condition of anonymity. The official said the matter was being studied, no decisions had been taken, and that, to the official's knowledge, none were imminent. The underlying reason for weighing the step is that non-U.S. companies now able to do business with Iran because of last year's nuclear deal find it difficult to do so without at some point touching the U.S. financial system. The official said such companies are getting conflicting messages from their own governments, which encourage trade with Iran, and from Washington, which emphasizes that it'll enforce sanctions rigorously. Is the Brazilian president taking the fall for a whole class of corrupt politicians? Brazil's president Dilma Rousseff is fighting for her political survival. She has been abandoned by the party that was her main coalition partner, leaving her leading a minority government. And a combination of the worst recession in years, an unprecedented corruption investigation, and a push to have her impeached has left her government close to collapse. Rousseff is now struggling to save both her own reputation and the legacy of the Workers' Party, which has ruled Brazil for 13 years. But is she taking the fall for a whole class of corrupt politicians? Viewers will take a... Protesters say Turkey's Erdogan must step down. Sickening sex abuse alleged in car by UN peacekeepers. Police workers and students clash again in Paris. South Korea repatriates Chinese soldiers killed in Korean War. And crackdown on illegal migrants bound for Hong Kong. Welcome back to Millennium TV News. Demonstrators unite in Washington, D.C., calling Turkish President Tayyip Erdogan a terrorist whose rule must be overthrown. They came to protest against Turkish President Tayyip Erdogan, calling him, among other things, a terrorist for his hardline stance against Turkey's Kurdish community seeking independence. Erdogan was delivering a speech across the road at the Brookings Institution, while thousands of miles away in the Turkish city of Diyarbakir, police were investigating a bomb attack that killed several of their colleagues, an attack Erdogan calls outrageous. He says, "Terör örgütü."
As we corner the terrorist organizations, the terrorist organization shows its heinous face through such attacks and acts.
Southeastern Turkey has been beset by violence since a ceasefire between the outlawed Kurdistan Workers' Party and the government collapsed last July.
Thousands of militants have been killed in the conflict. Erdogan says his government's fight is a simple matter of Turkish security.
Long live Kurdistan!
But these protesters say it's time to give the Kurds what they want and hold Erdogan accountable.
UN and French peacekeepers accused of grim abuses in restive African nation, including bestiality with children. The United Nations announced 108 new sexual abuse cases allegedly by international peacekeepers in Central African Republic, with the vast majority of victims being children. A report by a US-based advocacy group said three girls in car told UN staff they were tied up and forced to have sex with a dog by a French military commander in 2014. UN spokesman Stephanie Durajic on Thursday called the allegations shocking to the core and promised exemplary disciplinary action if they are proven to be true. France's UN ambassador Francoise Deletre called the allegations sickening and odious. The accusations dating from 2013 through last year were first announced by the group AIDS-Free World late on Wednesday. Durajic told reporters that UN can't confirm the allegations late on Wednesday. A report published in late January condemned the UN for failing to respond to allegations of child abuse against peacekeepers in the Central African Republic. The independent investigation said the UN handling of the case was seriously flawed, accusing of it not taking the required action after the alleged abuse of young boys by French soldiers became known.
Over the past week, UNICEF staff from the office in Bangui have undertaken four visits to meet with the four alleged victims. UNICEF is also working with local partners to help the girls receive medical care and is assessing their psychosocial needs.
Transportation workers and high school students are protesting against plans for a pro-business loosening of the country's protective labor laws. No! French rail and air traffic suffered serious disruption on Thursday after transport staff stopped work and took to the streets along with high school students to challenge plans for a pro-business loosening of the country's protective labor laws. The day of protest, the fourth in a month, has been billed by a local media as a make-or-break test of strength for President Francois Hollande. Plagued by low popularity and a jobless rate stuck stubbornly about 10% as mean 2017 elections loom. The three protests to date have been low-key by the standards of past French strikes, but organizers hope to mobilize more people this time. South Korea holds a handover ceremony to return the remains of 36 Chinese soldiers killed during the 1950-53 Korean War to China. South Korean honor guards repatriate the remains of 36 Chinese soldiers killed during the Korean War. Soldiers fought for North Korea and were returned in a symbolic gesture of friendship. South Korea already sent 437 sets of remains to China in 2014 and 68 in 2015. 3 million soldiers and civilians were killed in the war and 5 million became refugees. Police arrest thousands of illegal migrants attempting to get into Hong Kong. Police stop a van in Shenzhen, China as it attempts to cross into neighboring Hong Kong. Inside are illegal migrant workers, some of Pakistani and Vietnamese descent. They are just some of the 3,000 or so illegal migrants who have been arrested since early February as part of a crackdown on smuggling rings. Both Hong Kong and mainland Chinese police forces were involved in the effort. Director of Border Control Department of Ministry of Public Security, Yin Chengjun, says,
and their main objective was to make money working as laborers. This has triggered various other crime problems. It has seriously disturbed the socio-economic order of the mainland and has affected the social stability of Hong Kong.
Chinese state media say crime syndicates in Hong Kong were the chief culprits behind the smuggling. The migrants chose to enter Hong Kong through mainland China because of lax border controls and easily obtainable visas.
We'll take a short break here. Now the business news. Asian shares and the dollar both lost more ground on Friday as investors began the new quarter in a cautious mood, with glimmers of life in China's economy offset by a darkening mood in Japan. Activity in China's vast manufacturing sector expanded in March for the first time in 9 months as the official Purchasing Managers Index surprised at 50.2. Econon, a private version of the PMI, also beat forecasts by rising to its highest in 13 months. Yet markets seemed underwhelmed and shares in Shanghai. SSEC drifted 0.6% lower, not helping was Standard & Poor's decision to cut China's credit outlook negative, saying Beijing's reform agenda was likely to proceed more slowly than expected. MetLife has done it. GE Capital is hoping to do so. Companies believed to pose a risk to the economy for being too big to fail are trying to get the problematic designation dropped.
7 years after the financial crisis and too big to fail are still dirty words on Wall Street. So much so that MetLife successfully fought to lose the designation along with the regulatory burdens and extra costs that come along with it. MetLife was one of four non-banks, including American International Group, Prudential Financial, and GE Capital, that were slapped with the description, deeming them so important to the financial system that if they failed, they would drag the economy down the drain with them. Olivia Oran covers the banking sector for Reuters and says the MetLife ruling is a game changer.
So it's pretty significant. I think you will expect to see other large asset management and insurance companies that are also going to be challenging their designation. GE, for example, we know that they're in the process of doing it. AIG as well, probably in the process of doing that.
But AIG has a tougher argument to make. After all, its business relationships were so entangled in the mortgage mess behind the financial crisis that taxpayers had to put up $182 billion to bail it out. The insurance giant had no other choice but to go on a diet, but it wasn't alone. All of the big banks are still considered too big to fail. JPMorgan Chase, Citigroup, Bank of America, Goldman Sachs, Morgan Stanley, and even American Express. Before the crisis, these guys were in a race to get bigger. Now, they're moving in the opposite direction.
Simple is the new sexy is like what some of the analysts are saying. You have them moving towards simpler businesses. They require less capital. They're easier to explain to investors. They don't have a lot of the risk associated with them.
But becoming smaller hasn't made the target on the group's back any less visible. There are still calls to break up the banks by politicians who fear the industry is still too big for the economy to control.
Now the science, technology, and environment news. Automakers say the U.S. could be on the verge of a self-driving car revolution if only the country's road system and infrastructure was able to keep up.
Sorry to do that pass again.
With the rise of autonomous vehicles, car makers and transportation experts say they're driving into the future. But as they turn the corner, they're hitting some major roadblocks, specifically a crumbling U.S. infrastructure. Paul Lewis is the vice president of policy for the Eno Center of Transportation think tank. He says the advancing technology will only go so far.
That technology has progressed pretty rapidly over the last couple of years. But on the other hand, that does not work very well when it's raining or it's snowing or the road has water on it or any kind of precipitation, or if road markings are either not very well marked or they're falling apart or anything like that.
Lewis and other experts believe crumbling roads, poor markings, and uneven signage could delay America's self-driving car revolution for years. With an estimated 65% of U.S. roads affected, it's costing millions to adapt autonomous cars to drive on them. Some of that time and money is going into tools like radar and LIDAR. LIDAR can help produce a 3D map that provides the car's location on the road within centimeters. John Rostevsky is vice president of reality capture at the German location intelligence company here.
And this even works when the physical infrastructure is not there. So if a vehicle is driving on a freeway with, say, faded lane markings, the map will contain that information and give all that context to the vehicle in the absence of the sensors seeing it themselves.
Transportation officials hope that greater acceptance of self-driving cars will mean more political pressure for better roads. But until that happens, self-driving cars may be left idling at the starting line.
A gorilla named Susie is helping provide fresh insight into the genetic similarities and differences between people and these endangered apes that are among our closest living relatives. Scientists on Thursday unveiled an upgraded version of the gorilla genome based on DNA from Susie, an 11-year-old Western lowland gorilla at the Columbus Zoo and Aquarium in Ohio, that fills in many gaps present in the first gorilla genetic map published in 2012. The new research revealed that gorillas and humans are slightly more closely related genetically than previously recognized, with the genomes diverging by just 1.6%. Only chimpanzees and bonobos are more closely related to humans. The new genome shows that some areas of genetic differences include the immune and reproductive systems, sensory perception, the production of keratin, a key protein in the structure of hair, fingernails and skin, and the regulation of insulin, the hormone that governs blood sugar levels. The United States and China confirmed Thursday that they will sign the Paris Climate Change Agreement in New York on April 22nd, a move that officials hope will help the accord enter into force this year. The world's two biggest greenhouse gas emitters issued a joint presidential statement in which they called on other countries to sign the accord next month with a view to bringing the Paris Agreement into force as early as possible. Leaders from nearly 200 countries forged the landmark agreement to transform the world's fossil fuel-driven economy on December 12, after 4 years of fraught negotiations. But the Paris Climate Agreement needs at least 55 countries representing at least 55% of global emissions to formally exit it to before it can enter into force. Todd Stern, the U.S. climate envoy who helped broker the deal in Paris, said hitting the threshold as soon as possible will benefit countries that are vulnerable to climate change. Now the entertainment news. first female winner of Pritzker Prize designed several buildings, including a stadium under construction in Qatar. Iraqi-born British architect Zaha Hadid, the first female winner of the top Pritzker Architecture Prize, has died at the age of 65. Hadid died after suffering a heart attack at a Miami hospital where she was receiving treatment for bronchitis, her design firm said in a statement on Thursday. Zaha Hadid was widely regarded to be the greatest female architect in the world today. The statement said, born in Baghdad in October 31, 1950, Hadid first studied mathematics at the American University in Lebanon before pursuing architecture at the Architectural Association in London in 1972. In 1979, she established her own practice in London, the Zaha Hadid Architects. The actress says playing a high-priced call girl in the new show was easier than she thought it would be. Filmmaker Steven Soderbergh shines a light on the world of transactional relationships with his new show, The Girlfriend Experience. Stars of the 13.5-hour limited series, including Riley Keough, celebrated the show at a red carpet screening in New York on Wednesday. "I'm just looking forward to, you know, seeing people's reactions," said Keough, who is the daughter of Lisa Mary Presley and granddaughter of Elvis. The show, which will air on U.S. network Stars, follows last student Christine Reed, played by Keough, as she juggles school and life as a high-priced escort, providing clients with emotional and sexual relationships.
"I'm just looking forward to, you know, seeing people's reactions.
Now, I already have a couple of exceptional men in mind.
I thought it was going to be a lot more taxing emotionally and difficult, but it was actually like very easy because Christine's a very strong, like happy. She's fine with all the things."
"I like it that it's taboo. I think that's really provocative. I think those are fun things to work on. It's sort of, it's a genre that people have a lot of expectations about. And I think this project sort of subverts those in many ways. And I thought that was really interesting."
"I only do it a few times a month. I get off on it. I like the rush."
"He calls me Ashley.
Should I be Chelsea?
You can be whoever you want to be."
Beyonce launches a women's fitness clothing line called Ivy Park. Beyonce has launched a women's fitness clothing line featuring bodysuits, leggings, and headbands, named in part for her 4-year-old daughter, Blue Ivy. Called Ivy Park, the 200-piece activewear collection is a joint venture with British businessman Sir Philip Green, who owns the Topshop fashion chain. The collection will feature leggings, t-shirts, crop tops, and jackets, all designed for fitness and leisure wear. It'll go on sale at selected Topshop and high-end department stores around the world on April 14.
"And how I was a hero. I would look at the beauty around me, the sunshine through the trees. I would keep breathing. There are things I'm still afraid of. When I have to conquer those things, I still go back to that park. Where's your park?"
Now the sports news. Five players from the reigning World Cup champion women's soccer team have filed a federal wage complaint against the U.S. Soccer Federation, claiming they are underpaid. Goalie Hope Solo and four other players for the World Cup champion U.S. women's football team have filed a federal wage complaint charging they generate more income for the United States Soccer Federation but are paid less than male players. The athletes, including star scorer Carly Lloyd, claim some of them earn as little as 40% of what men's team players make. Lawyer Jeffrey Kessler said on Thursday in the complaint to the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission filed on Wednesday, the players asked for an investigation of the Federation, the governing body of all forms of football in the United States, and the women's employer. Living conditions and delayed salaries among concerns raised, but Qatar says reforms are being implemented. Workers in Qatar renovating a stadium for the 2022 World Cup have suffered rights abuses 2 years after the tournament's organizers drafted worker welfare standards in the wake of criticism, Amnesty International said. According to a report released on Thursday, dozens of construction workers from Nepal and India were housed in squalid accommodation and barred from leaving the country by employers in Qatar who confiscated their passports. The Supreme Committee for Delivery and Legacy, the organizers for the 2022 World Cup, told media that the conditions reported were not representative of the entire workforce on Khalifa. Between February and May 2015, Amnesty says it interviewed 132 workers involved in the rebuilding of the Khalifa Stadium, a sporting complex in Doha that is said to host one of the knockout games of the tournament.
The very common ones are delayed pay or non-payment of wages for very long periods. You know, we've seen some workers going for many, many months without being paid, having worked extremely long hours in very, sometimes very harsh conditions.
Let's have a look at Millennium TV News recap. Obama hosts world leaders at White House. U.S. South Korea Japan pledge security cooperation. India bridge collapse kills 14, scores feared trapped. Republicans alarmed at talk U.S. may ease Iran trade. And will Brazil's Dilma Rousseff be impeached? You are up to date with your top stories so far here on Millennium TV, and don't forget to log into www.millenniumtv.net. Thank you for staying with us. Allah Hafiz.